Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the first of three meetings tonight. My name is Dennis Funkley, Mayor of the City of Beech Grove. And at this time, we will convene our Board of Sanitation meeting for Monday, February the 6th, 2017. In lieu of a roll call, I will ask each participant to introduce themselves, beginning on my far right.
Ed Bell.
Dan McMillan, Clerk Treasurer.
Sandy Seward.
And our City Attorney Craig Wiley is stepping up to the podium. This evening, Board, you have been given a printed copy of the minutes of the previous meeting dated Tuesday, January 17th. Floor is open for any questions, comments, or corrections.
I have none, thank you.
I have none.
No questions, comments, or corrections. I'll ask for a motion to approve the minutes as presented.
I'll make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 I also vote aye and the motion carries. Thank you. This evening, Board, we have five pages of wastewater claims in the amount of $59,042.58. The floor is open for questions or comments.
I have none, thank you.
I have none this evening either.
No questions or comments. I'll ask for a motion to approve the wastewater claims dated February the 6th, 2017, in the amount of $59,042.58.
I'll make said motion.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I also vote aye and the motion carries. We have no unfinished business to carry over from the previous meeting. No new business tonight. Comments from Board members?
I have none.
I have none, thank you.
If not, I'll ask for a motion to adjourn the Board of Sanitation meeting.
I'll make said motion.
I'll second.
All those in favor, aye?
Aye.
Meeting is adjourned. We will convene the Board of Public Works and Safety meeting in 5 minutes. Thank you. Good evening and welcome to the second of three meetings tonight. My name is Dennis Funkley, Mayor of the City of Beech Grove. And at this time, we'll convene our Board of Public Works and Safety meeting for Monday, February the 6th, 2017. In lieu of a roll call, I will ask each participant to introduce themselves, beginning on my far right.
Ed Bell.
Dan McMillan, Clerk Treasurer.
Craig Wiley, City Attorney.
Sandy Seward.
Thank you, Board. You have been given a printed copy of the minutes of the previous meeting dated January 17th, 2017. Floor is open for questions, comments, or corrections.
I have none, thank you.
I have none.
No questions, comments, or corrections. I'll ask for a motion to approve the minutes as presented.
I'll make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 I also vote aye and the motion carries. This evening, Board, you have been given a docket of 48 pages of corporate claims in the amount of $1,363,586.45. The floor is open for questions or comments.
I do have a question, please, on page 24. Dan, it's for the bond. One of the amount is $95,000, the other one was $12,000. What
right.
are those two for, please?
This is our 2012 bond that we took out. One of them is for principal and one is for interest.
Thank you. That was my only question. Thank you.
Questions or comments? If there's no questions or comments, I'll ask for a motion to approve the corporate claims dated February 6, 2017, in the amount of $1,363,586.45.
I'll make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 I also vote aye and the motion carries. Thank you. We have no unfinished business to carry over from the previous meeting. Under new business, we have several items. The first item this evening is bid opening for the 2017 paving phase two project. And before we open the bids, we will only open the bids tonight and read them aloud. We will not award any bid this evening. We will award the bid at the next Board of Works meeting on February the 21st in these chambers at 6 p.m. So there will be no bid award tonight. I'll defer to Board Member Sandy Seward to open the bids and read them aloud, please.
The first sealed bids is from Reith Riley. The total bid amount from Reith Riley is $829,853.95.
$829,853.95. Andy, could you set that up? There we go. Thank you.
The next sealed bid is from Smith Projects. And the total bid from Smith is $645,019.60. The next sealed bid is from Midwest Paving. And their total bid is $655,054.90. And the next sealed bid is from E and B Paving. The total bid amount is $721,550. The next sealed bid is from Calumet. And the total bid amount is $685,165.97. The next sealed bid is from Harding Group. And the total bid amount is $720,838.71. Next sealed bid is Grady Brothers. Their total bid amount is $947,000. Next sealed bid is Robertson Paving. You don't want me to get into this envelope. And the sealed bid from Robertson's is $693,275.90. And the last sealed bid is from Milestone Contractors. And Milestone's bid is $956,000. And that is all of the sealed bids.
We would like to thank everybody who put a bid in for this paving project. This is the largest project that we've done since we've been in office, and it's the largest participation from companies. So I thank each and every one of you. And at this time, our consulting engineer, Bill, could you come up and get the bid packets and review them on our behalf, please? Thank you very much for bidding, and thanks for coming out this evening. And you're free to leave. The next order of business is 2017 sanitary sewer lining project. Notice to proceed. This time I'll call up our friends from Wessler Engineering.
Thank you, Board. Thank you for the time tonight. My name is Joe Bartos, project engineer with Wessler. I'm here today to submit for your consideration and review the scope and cost estimate for the 2017 sanitary sewer rehab project. I've got some packets for your review as well. So just basically kind of going through the scope of the project here. On the aerial exhibits, you'll see figures 1 through 4. And the way we've set up this contract is for a base quote as well as a mandatory ad alternate quote. So the scope of the base portion of the project, there, figure 1, you'll see one 8-inch segment along Edwards Street. Two 8-inch segments along 4th Avenue and Ash Street. Two segments along Churchman and between 18th and 19th. One 8-inch, one 10-inch. And then three 8-inch segments roughly in the area of 20th and Churchman. That works out to be roughly 2,100 feet of 8-inch CIPP lining and 420 feet of 10-inch CIPP lining. Those are all in existing sewers. That work also includes lateral reinstatement and protruding lateral removal. And for that portion of the project, our engineer's cost estimate came in at $66,215. Moving on to the ad alternate. That includes roughly 1,100 feet of 8-inch CIPP along Royal Road. I'm sorry, 10-inch CIPP. All, again, in existing sanitary sewers. And that work also includes the lateral reinstatement as well. And the estimate for that portion of the project is $29,900, bringing the total for the base bid and ad alternate combined to $96,115. We planned on reaching out for quotes to contractors Miller Pipeline, In Situ Form, and Lane Inliner. And then our proposed or planned schedule, at least at this point, is to hopefully open quotes at the next board meeting on the 21st. Potentially award the contract sometime in March with a construction start date late March, early April. And then we've budgeted 90 days for substantial completion for this project, with final completion coming 30 days thereafter. So tonight, basically just here to answer any questions you may have and get approval to reach out to those contractors for quotes.
Thank you. Information for the board, this is probably, Brad, the fifth or sixth project we've done like this. And it's really moved the sanitary sewer system up, and it's much better than it was. We have budgeted $150,000 in construction for this type of activity. And I take it that these are the worst areas that Wessler has identified?
Yeah, so as we've kind of identified these areas in conjunction with Phil and Brad, we've moved kind of in a prioritized fashion down the list. And as you mentioned, this is probably the fifth or sixth one here in the past 5 to 7 years. And so these are probably not the worst we've seen, but they are certainly the worst ones that are left out there, I would say.
And originally, I advised Wessler around $75,000. The $66,000 is what we should do. The board can decide to bump it up if they would like. The funding would be there. It's totally up to them. So I'll open it up for any questions or comments.
I do have a question. Are these systems currently failing? Or are we trying to catch them before they fail?
They're in a state of probably pending failure. The idea here being that we want to catch them before they do collapse. There are some issues at the lateral connections where these services actually tie in to the mains themselves, but they're not, it's not imminent failure, I guess I would say, but it would be good to catch these before something catastrophic happens.
Are our residents, are they currently seeing any kind of a backup as a result of?
I'm not aware of any backups, okay. Brad. No.
No issues, okay.
Come on up.
Good evening. No, there weren't any specific incidents that necessarily prompted this. We've tried to be responsible and continue the lining process through as much of the system as we can. One of the things that we fight as being someone who pays citizens to treat our wastewater is I&I, as Joe can tell you about, and that's infiltration and inflow. And so in your system, there's always going to be points where rainwater gets in, and ultimately you're paying to treat that. Your goal is to cut that down as much as possible. The last thing you want to do is pay the plant out at Southport or Belmont to treat water that is basically just rainwater. So in a lot of these unlined mains, you have points where joints are open enough that rain can get in. So the idea is when you line them, not only do you structurally increase the integrity of the pipe, at that point, I think, what's the lifespan of a lined pipe? 50 years?
50 years.
50 years. So you're also sealing off the rain's ability to get in. So it's there's dual benefit there. So it's a responsible activity as the owner of the system to do it. But no, we've not had any necessarily, I'd say, cataloged incidents of things that have prompted us to do this. It's just more of us trying to continue on. Lining everything that we have would be the goal ultimately.
Actually, I think our calls have gone down. We don't
feel near the amount of calls we did when we first started.
Yeah, it's gone down dramatically. Really has.
And Brad,
thanks.
By lining it, does that help keep tree roots out?
Yeah, it does. A lot of the tree roots are infiltrating into the laterals, and so obviously us lining our main doesn't always affect that. That's obviously a private issue, but yeah, we've knocked out a lot of those sections where we've had habitual root issues. South Fourth was one. We've lined that a couple of years ago. So these aren't necessarily root issues that we're addressing now. I think we've eliminated almost all of those, but it certainly does eliminate that. And as you televise a pipe and you see all the roots coming in, when you line it, you cut those roots out, you line it, and then you don't see that again. So if there are root issues, it does take care of it.
All right, good. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, Brad.
Any other questions or comments from board members?
I have none. Thank you.
If not, the board has two options. The first option of not to exceed $66,000, or the add-on not to exceed $96,115. But I'll leave it up to the board for a motion.
I would make a motion to go ahead and move the $96,115.
Not to exceed?
Not to exceed.
I'll make said motion. For the 96.
You made the motion and Ed second, or vice versa?
Yeah, I made the motion, but...
Then I'll second.
Okay.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 I also vote aye, and the motion carries. We meet next Tuesday, or 2 weeks from now on Tuesday, February the 21st at 6. So if you folks could have a recommendation to the board, we would be very grateful.
Absolutely.
Bill, same way with paving. All right, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda is notice to proceed with Franciscan Trail. I'll defer to city legal for this. We've already done this twice, but Crossroads wants to do it again for some reason.
Essentially, they just wanted to make sure that we're on the same fiscal cycle for the payment. So that's why they want us to renew it this year. I thought my legal opinion was it was okay to do it the first one, but they want some clarification.
Nothing's changed, except they wanted a clean copy for some reason. So motion to approve.
I'll make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 I also vote aye, and the motion carries. And if we could sign that, we'll surrender it to Trent. The next three items pertain to promotions within the fire department. Chief?
Mayor and board, I come before you today to ask for the approval of the promotion of Scott Johnson to the rank of lieutenant. If approved, Scott will fill the open position on B shift and be assigned the merit rank of lieutenant. Scott completed all aspects of the promotional testing process and was approved by the Beech Grove Merit Board. His base salary will be $2,579.28 per pay period. This increase of position pay is in our 2017 budget. With your approval, the effective date will start next payroll on February 11th, 2017.
Comments or questions from board members?
I have none.
Now I'll ask for a motion to approve the promotion of Scott Johnson.
I'll make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 I also vote aye, and the motion carries.
I'm going to ask for Scott and his family to come up so I can hand him his badge. I do want to say thank you for your support this year in 2017. 2017 is a year of change for the fire department. When we look at what's going on, our new personnel that we are able to hire, that we'll be swearing in tonight at the city council meeting, plus our promotional processes this evening, they lay the foundation blocks for the Beech Grove Fire Department, the city of Beech Grove. They will continue on far after I retire and a lot of the guys in this room move on. These guys will still be here carrying on that torch, and we're very proud of them.
Go closer. Go closer. You can go. Go.
I
I want to thank the Merit Board. Also want to thank Board of Works for this opportunity. And my crew and I will continue to provide the best service that we can for the citizens of Beech Grove.
Congratulations, Scott.
Thank you very much.
All right, Chief.
Mayor and Board, I come before you today to ask for approval of promotion of Danny Miller to the rank of operator. If approved, Danny will fill the open position on B shift. Danny completed all aspects of the promotional testing process. His base salary will be $2,465.15 per pay period. This increase of position pay is in our 2017 budget. With your approval, this will take effect February 11th, 2017.
Questions or comments from board members? If not, I'll ask for a motion to approve the promotion of Danny Miller to operator.
Makes the motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I also vote aye and the motion carries.
Thank you. I'm going to have Danny come up real quick. Jim, would you like to explain the process?
Good evening, Board. Just a quick note about the engineer process. We, back during the summer, with the other full-time engineers, put together a evaluation process for the new engineers, which consisted of a written test, some oral interviews, and a skills exam where we went out to Wayne Township and used their training tower to do several pumping and water flow evolutions. So these folks that you're going to see tonight earned their way to up here, just like any other position on the fire department. They educated themselves and practiced and did a very fine job. So I just wanted to let you know that they worked hard to be here tonight, so we greatly appreciate them. So thank you again.
Danny, you want to say something?
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Board. I appreciate this opportunity, and I will do my very best to keep my crew safe and everybody else that I come in contact with.
Wait a minute. No, I'm not done. This was a Wishard project. He came over as a civilian paramedic. And I'm going to go back. He's got two brothers.
Two brothers, yes.
And all three of them were Eagle Scouts. So it tells you a little bit about his family. Met his wife, was a girlfriend at the time.
Fiance.
And I told her when I first met her, her name was Lindsay, and I said, I will never, ever forget that name, because that's my daughter's name. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Congratulations, Danny.
One more, Chief.
All right. Mayor and Board, I come before you today to ask for approval of promotion of Ryan Madigan to the rank of operator. If approved, Ryan will fill the open position on C shift. Ryan completed all aspects of the promotional testing process. His base salary will be $2,468.28 per pay period. This increase of position pays in our 2017 budget. With your approval, this will take effect February 12th, 2017. And the reason it's the 12th is Danny finished first during the promotional process, and Ryan finished second. So if that's ever an issue on shift, we'll separate the dates.
Okay. Floor is open for questions or comments. If not, I'll ask for a motion to approve the promotion of Ryan Madigan to operator.
I'll make said motion.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. I also vote aye, and the motion carries.
Ryan, congratulations.
I just want to say thank you. I appreciate it, and hopefully I don't screw up too bad. Thanks.
We're off to a good start. Chief, you have one more item, educational opportunity.
Yes. Dear Board, at this time I would like to ask the Board of Works and Safety for the approval to allow firefighter Amber Clouser to attend the Naval Postgraduate School for Homeland Defense. This program is very competitive for admissions, and Amber would be competing nationally with the top applicants. The course will allow Amber to complete her master's degree The knowledge gained from this program would not only be beneficial for the fire department, but also for the citizens of Beech Grove. Amber would be placed on educational leave for a 40-hour week for the required days off during the program. If accepted, the course anticipation graduation date will be in 2019. Amber is committed to use vacation personal days in conjunction with educational leave not to cause an undue burden on the city. Amber will be responsible for all other costs of the course. Thank you for your consideration. And a little background on this course. Amber's here this evening if you have any questions for her. But this is a FEMA-sponsored Homeland Security. And I treat this course as any other course from FEMA or the National Fire Academy. She will be going more than the normal time for the Fire Academy. We allowed 2 weeks off per year. This will exceed those 2 weeks. So that's what I want to bring to the board. There's some built-in safety features with this. If we have another applicant from the Beech Grove Fire Department apply, they will only allow two from our department attend at once, not to cause a burden on the city, the people, the classes. But this is just a fantastic opportunity for Amber, and she is in the process of applying, but I'm just asking for your support so we can ensure that she has the time off, and just very proud of her, and this program's an excellent opportunity for the city and the fire department.
Thank you, Chief. Floor is open for question or comments.
I have none.
Now I'll ask for a motion to approve the chief's request for educational leave for Amber Clouser.
I'll make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I vote aye as well, and the motion carries.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rob.
Not on your agenda, board. We have two renewals for handicap parking. I'll defer to the clerk to go through them.
The first one is Linda Murdoch. And like the mayor said, this is a renewal, and everything's, you know, she's turned in all the information we need for this, so I would recommend you approve it.
Motion to approve.
I'll make said motion.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I also vote aye, and the motion carries. We have one more.
The other one is Marcia Helton.
Nelson.
Okay, thank you. Anyway, same way, renewal. All the paperwork has been turned in, and again, I would recommend approval.
Motion to approve the request.
Make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I also vote aye, and the motion carries. That concludes new business this evening. The State of the City address will be at 6:45 p.m. this evening right here. Closing comments from board members. Ed?
Well, if you're trying to figure out why he is sitting next to me.
I like him.
He's going to be my replacement sitting here at the board. It works. It's been a privilege to sit and handle city business. I was able to know a lot behind the scenes on the financing and how everything works. So that'd be about it.
Okay. Sandy?
Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you.
Any comments?
Thank you.
All right. I would like to thank Ed for his service. When we first came into office, Dave sat on the Board of Public Works and Safety, and then I said I would alternate Dave and Ed. I left Ed on for a couple years, and every once in a while, Dave used to remind me about it. But anyway, both of them are good for the city, and Ed, I just want to thank you for working with us. The city's better because of this board and this on the councils, and the decisions that have been made to move the city forward, like tonight. So I wish you the best, and we will have other opportunities for Ed down the road. So having said that, the State of the City will be in 5 minutes. Motion to adjourn.
I'll make said motion.
I'll second.
We are adjourned at 6:40 p.m. Good evening and welcome to the third and final meeting tonight. My name is Dennis Buckley, Mayor of the City of Beech Grove. And at this time, we will convene our Common Council meeting for Monday, February the 6th, 2017. In lieu of a roll call, I will ask each participant to introduce themselves, beginning on my left.
Buddy Templin, Councilman at Large.
Jim Brooks, Councilman at Large.
Dave Harrison, Council of District 5.
Dan McMillan, Clerk Treasurer.
Craig Wiley, City Attorney.
Ed Bell, District 2.
Elizabeth Lamping, District 1.
Chris Duffer, District 3.
Mayor, Councilor Day is sick this evening, so he won't be here.
Okay. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. We have a couple special presentations tonight. The first one is a swearing in of new fire department members. So, Chief, if you could present your new employees, please.
First employee is Andrew Johnson.
Raise your right hand. I, Andrew Johnson, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Indiana, and that I will faithfully, impartially, and diligently discharge the duties of firefighter for the City of Beech Grove, Indiana, in accordance to law and to the best of my ability. Congratulations.
Thank you. Chris Harper.
Chris, raise your right hand, please. I, Christopher Harper, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Indiana, and that I will faithfully, impartially, and diligently discharge the duties of firefighter for the City of Beech Grove, Indiana, according to law and to the best of my ability.
I do.
Congratulations.
Thank all you guys too.
And Joe Anglin.
Who?
Who?
Wait a minute. We go way back, so I could tease him. Is that all right, Joe?
That's fair enough.
All right, Joe, please raise your right hand. I, Joseph Anglin, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Indiana, and that I will faithfully, impartially, and diligently discharge the duties of firefighter for the City of Beech Grove, Indiana, according to law and to the best of my ability.
I do.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
The next special president, our next announcement, Council, is an EDC appointment. After conferring with the Council President Pro Tem, he is recommending that we move forward. So the Council, Common Council, has an appointment on that commission. So I'll defer at the next meeting to the President Pro Tem to proceed on who they may want to put on that board. All right. Thank you. You have been given a printed copy of the previous meeting minutes dated January 3rd, 2017. The floor is open for questions, comments, or any correction.
I want to be back there. Can I go back there? I want to be.
If there are no corrections, comments, or questions, I'll ask for a motion to approve the minutes dated January 3rd, 2017 as presented.
I'll make said motion, Mayor.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the same sign. I'll defer to our City Attorney for any public comments.
Yeah, nobody signed up. Anybody want to speak?
We will move to committee reports. First up, Mayor's Youth Council.
Hi, I'm Bishop from the high school. This weekend, we're having the our play, The Crucible. It's going to be really fun. Hope you all go. Last weekend, we had a swim meet, and we did phenomenal. I don't remember the exact standings of everyone, but I also don't understand swimming. So, yeah, that's about it.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Quick month with January, just getting up and started for the second semester. So, as you mentioned, our girls basketball team finished really strong. Just a heartbreaker in the sectional. Boys basketball is this Wednesday, so we're still enjoying them. And the Crucible will be interesting this weekend, a very dramatic play, but a classic, American classic, so the kids are excited. Any questions for us?
Don't we have about five advancing in the wrestling to the wrestling regionals?
Yes, our wrestlers are doing very, very well right now. So we're trying not to jinx them in any way, but we're excited to see where they go. Anything else? All right, it is a quick month, so thanks so much. Have a great night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Council, you should have RDC report, Greenscape report, compliance report, and public safety report. We'll hear from ABC. Ashley, do you have anything tonight?
Good evening. We had our ABC meeting today. We had one renewal, and that was for Walmart store. And they had no violations. So our next meeting will be in March, the first Monday in March. Any questions?
Yeah, Ashley, how many people are on the alcohol board?
I'm the only one for Beech Grove.
Okay.
And then we have for Lawrence and Speedway, there's a member. And then Indianapolis has four.
Okay.
So
I was just trying to figure out how many altogether when you guys are there. So.
Well, for to vote on Beech Grove, it's the four for Indianapolis and myself.
Okay.
So.
Hey, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Thanks.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ashley.
And the last report is financial report, Dan.
Okay. This is our 2016 year-end financial report. This is my fifth year of giving the annual financial report to council and the citizens of Beech Grove at the February City Council meeting. It has been my privilege every year. We completed the closing on the tax anticipation warrant in January. We continue to reduce the amount we borrow each year. For the 2017 year, we are borrowing $1,295,000. The total borrowed on the tax anticipation warrant for 2016 was $1,479,594. That represents approximately a $185,000 decrease in borrowing. Since taking office in 2012, it represents an overall decrease of almost $1.2 million. We finished 2016 with a balance in our corporate bank account of $4,328,486.05. In 2015, we finished with a balance in the corporate account of $2,882,256.73. That is an increase over 2015 of almost $1.5 million. We obtained a lease purchase agreement for the purchase of one 2016 Ford Explorer XL 4x4 and six 2016 Ford F-250 vehicles for the Department of Public Works and Parks Department. And we once again used the HELP program through the Indiana Bond Bank. With the HELP program, the Indiana Bond Bank performs the bidding process and provides us with results at no additional cost to the municipalities, including attorney or financing fees. The interest rate is 1.762%. The payments are $26,304.96 semi-annually and are due in March and September. We financed it for 5 years. All our lease purchase agreements on equipment are financed for 5 years. The debt reserve on the 2005A revenue bond for sewage works, which we refinanced in 2015 and resulted in a savings of approximately $70,000, as of 12/31/2016 had a balance owing of just over $600,000. As of 12/31/2016, the debt reserve account had a balance of $64,181 and is held in Huntington National Bank and is tracked through Keystone. The outstanding balance on our 2012 bond at the end of 2016 was approximately $1.4 million. Our 2004 SRF bond, which was financed for 20 years, has a balance owing of just over $1 million as of 12/31/2016. The debt reserve account had a balance of $136,377.66 and is held in the Bank of New York Mellon and is tracked through Keystone. The RDC refinanced their 2005 and 2007 bonds this year. The annual report for 2016 has been completed and entered into the Indiana Gateway and the city website. It is available on the website, Annual Reports. We now have a capital assets inventory that is kept updated and is included on the Gateway and the city website. The Indiana Gateway, which was established to promote the open door law, has grown each year. The first year for the Gateway was 2012. The Gateway includes the annual report from Keystone, our accounting program, the municipality questionnaire, enterprise questionnaire, public officials information questionnaire, departments questionnaires, capital assets, grants, debts, leases, pensions, account payables and receivables, and upload for public official bonds, and a risk assessment report that includes an upload for the salary ordinance, the December 2016 bank rec, credit card ordinance, and more. . 2013 was the first year in many that we increased the paving budget. It has been increased from $205,000 in 2012 to $530,000 for 2017. It was $601,000 in 2016. In 2014 was the first year an appropriation was created for sidewalks. In 2017, we have $45,000 budgeted for sidewalks. The increase in public safety LOAD tax that was approved a couple years ago by the Indianapolis City County Council has allowed the city of Beech Grove to pay $397,000 in cash for a fire truck, $90,000 towards new police vehicles, over $63,000 in body armor for the police department, over $46,000 in turnout gear for the fire department, over $76,000 for an ambulance chassis and upgrades to the police department and fire departments. The revenues generated from these tax dollars can only be used for the fire and police departments. We monitor the revenues and expenditures in this fund closely and report the status of this fund to the fire and police departments in the third and fourth quarter, which when the fund and budget allows, they can make additional needed purchases. For an example, we have an appropriation that is for the police lobby and public safety extras. After review from the clerk treasurer's office, it was realized that an additional $110,000 was remaining in the appropriation and was funded. After reporting that to both chiefs, they could purchase the much needed body armor and turnout gear. These are expenditures that are critical to their safety and consequently critical to our safety as citizens. The 100R and annual report are completed in the clerk treasurer's office. The 2016 100R and annual report has been completed and submitted, accepted on the Indiana Gateway. The Indiana Gateway is a website that makes public information available for citizens to review. It contains information such as revenues and expenditures, all city debt, including both bonds and leases, grants, elected officials, and public employees' income. This year, the council had a budget committee, and they were very helpful in negotiating the budget. The 2017 budget for the city is just over $12,800,000. This includes public safety, LRS, MVH, debt service, pensions, and more. The 2017 budget for wastewater is approximately $3.3 million. The clerk treasurer's office monitors the appropriation revenues monthly to ensure we're on track and not overspending. So, to summarize, the city is in very good financial shape. The clerk treasurer's office continues to fill public information requests without bias or discrimination and in accordance with the law. We report the city finances monthly to the council as well as publish financial reports monthly on the website. We currently have two full-time clerks and two part-time clerks employed in the office. While the clerk treasurer's position is an elected position, the clerk's positions are not. In December of 2016, I swore clerk Debbie Springer in as deputy clerk. The position is in the 2017 salary ordinance and is budgeted. Our city website, which was built by a few volunteers and myself, continues to grow and is packed full of information. It is the promise I made to the citizens of Beech Grove to provide them with open, honest government. Our website volunteers continue to volunteer their services, and we thank them for their service to our community. To date, the website has cost the taxpayers $0 because it is staffed by volunteer, and a local business continues to pay the annual fees. The website has received praise from mayors and clerk treasurers and professionals across the state, as well as auditors from the State Board of Accounts. I have attached the bank balances for January and the debt service for 2017 for your review. Both are available on the website for the citizens' review. The past 5 years are also available on the website for your review. They can be found under archived documents. As always, my door is always open. If you have any questions or concerns, please don't hesitate to stop by. And I would just like for you to know the corporate bank account, which is the one we use the most, had a balance as of the end of January, $4,568,921.70. And if anybody's got any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them.
If not, we'll move to unfinished business. There are a couple of, in your packet, you should have a couple of updates for the personnel manual. One of them is reimbursement of travel-related expenses. Another one is longevity benefits. And the third one is educational incentive pay that I do not want to bring forward to you tonight. I had some questions on this, and I want to take another look at it before I bring it forward. But tonight, if we could look at reimbursement of travel-related expenses to tighten it down, and the longevity benefit. The easy one is longevity. It's $100, and nothing's changed. It just needs to be put into the manual. It was omitted. It's in the salary ordinance. So that's a relatively easy one. The one I want to talk briefly about is the reimbursement of travel-related expenses. So, Dan, could you read that into the record, please?
Reimbursement of travel-related expenses, subsection A, general. Expenses described below which are incurred by a city employee related to that employee's official duties, responsibilities, or actions while participating in or on behalf of official city business shall be reimbursable. All travel must be approved by the employee's department head or for department heads by the mayor to ensure that claims fall within the department guidelines. Approval or denial shall be made on the basis of A, the department head's opinion as to the value of the request to the city. B, adequate funds being available in the current budget appropriation to cover the expenses. Subsection B, expenses, private vehicle mileage for travel related to official city business shall be reimbursable at the current mileage rate set by the Internal Revenue Service for business travel purposes as from time to time amended. Parking fees or tolls incurred and paid while a city employee is on official city business shall be reimbursable. However, the same shall not include traffic and parking tickets issued by any police department for an ordinance or state violation. Meals, lodging, and other reasonable expenses necessary and relevant to travel outside the Donut County, surrounding Marion County, and inside Marion County on official business shall be reimbursable. Meal expenses shall be paid at a maximum rate of $40 per day, including tips at least at 15% of the meal cost. Meals will only be reimbursable when an employee is unable to purchase or bring a meal due to previous overnight lodging necessity. Amounts over $40 would need to be approved by the department head or mayor. An amount equivalent to coach airfare, which are commonly understood to be coached rates, or any lower rate available, shall be reimbursed. Meeting expenses, seminar expenses, and such related items incurred while on official city business shall be reimbursable, whether or not inside the city corporate limits. Non-reimbursable expenses include, but are not limited to, in-room movies, alcohol laundry service, unless stay is over a week's length, saunas, massages, golf, personal telephone calls, either long distance or local, and any other unrelated service or entertainment not directly serving a business purpose. Any expenses resulting from companion travel of which the companion is not on official city business and which causes an expense over and above the expense reasonably incurred by the city employee shall not be reimbursable. Subsection C, claim submission requirements. Any claim for reimbursement of travel or expenses incurred while on official city business must be itemized and documented by receipts and must be submitted within 10 days after the completion of travel. In the event receipts are unavailable, lost or destroyed, the employee may obtain reimbursement by signing an affidavit that the expense was incurred on behalf of city business. Prior to submission for reimbursement, a claim must first be reviewed and authorized by the department head of the employee's department to confirm that the claims meet the conditions described by subsection A and B above. Registration fees, hotel reservation, and airline fares connected with seminars, workshops, schools, or other city-required travel may be paid in advance if supported by a fully itemized claim approved by the department head. Any savings resulting from changes in schedule or transportation shall be delivered to the Office of the Clerk Treasurer within 10 business days of travel completion, accompanied by written documentation. Any expenses charged by an employee on their personal charge cards will be reimbursed for the face value of the purchase. Later interest charges will not be reimbursed for any reason.
Floor is open for questions or comments. Chris.
On page two, on the second third paragraph, where it says any claim for reimbursement of travel or expenses incurred while on official city business must be, and they have the word itemizes, and I think it should be must be itemized.
Can you write that down, Dan?
Yeah, you got it circled on there.
Okay. I want to bring up, I think the Board of Works should approve the travel, whoever's going, wherever they're going. But I think when the department head brings the receipts down for payment, that's not a mayor or that's a clerk issue.
I agree with that 100%.
So I think we should word it to where I don't need to see that. I need to approve, the board needs to approve the travel and pre-travel or prepay or whatever, but the board doesn't need to see, the mayor doesn't, and the board doesn't need to see the receipts. That's a clerk issue. In my, that's my opinion.
I agree with you. I got a couple other issues too, but I'll let them go ahead with.
That's all I had.
Go ahead, Dan.
One of them, and I'm not sure exactly where it was at, but it says if the receipt is not available, they can sign off on that. Well, to me, that's money. And so many times in the past 5 years, we've gotten receipts back that are duplicates to someone else's that they were traveling with. We've had tips as high as 50% because the waitress in another state used to live in Beech Grove. And I just have an issue with that. If they don't have the original documentation, I think they need to treat it just like it is money. I mean, we do this with car washes. We just had one the last time it was turned in, and there was duplicates on the same car wash. So I think it's something we look through every time, and I think it's something that they need to do, and if they lose it, I'm sorry.
What would be the, and we I know we've talked about this, and I forget, what would be the State Board of Accounts thought on a receipt?
They want original receipts.
So maybe that should be incorporated in the language. What we're just trying to clean this up to where it's consistent. There's no issue with traveling and furthering your employment status and all of that, and making it better for the city, but we have to make sure it's consistent with how it's reimbursed. So that would be my recommendation to you folks, would be there would be no affidavit, it'd have to be original receipt, and would be paid after the event is done.
Is that something we want to insert language in here tonight, or do you guys want to just look at it and?
It doesn't matter. The longevity's cut and dried. I mean, it's. I would ask right. that you approve that tonight, and maybe you can forward comments on the travel thing back to us. But I definitely want to get it in the personnel manual.
So is and this is a.
This is to include this in the personnel manual that you've
right.
already approved.
But something like this, does this have to go through three readings?
I don't know. Greg?
It's an ordinance. Probably shouldn't go through three readings.
Okay, it's amended. It's amending the ordinance. We do three, we'll take it up in March. We could do three readings in March at the council approves it.
I'd be happy to work with the clerk treasurer and any other counselor to insert that language you're talking about, Mayor.
Okay. And the longevity.
Well, I'm talking about inserting the language you were talking about,
yes.
and the clerk treasurer as far as the receipts and that type of thing. The longevity, you said, is pretty cut and dried.
It's cut and dried.
Yeah.
All right.
Dennis, one thing on the longevity, and I've done it since I've been here, and actually it just makes it easier on me to be quite truthful about it, is I would like something put in there where it's offered to everybody at the beginning of each calendar year, because some of them don't reach their anniversary date until, let's say, March. I give it to everybody in January, and, you know, I'm sure sometimes we may have gotten stuck on something, but in order to go in there and watch every employee's date of hire and everything else, it's a tracking nightmare. So I would suggest that be put in there, that they receive that in January of every year.
I think that's what it says, Dan.
Oh, okay. I didn't.
Each full-time employee of the city shall receive a longevity increment of $100 per year at the beginning of the following year after their hire with the city as of January 1, 2016.
Okay.
So, I mean, I think that means it happens
yes.
on January 1st after their first full year here.
Right. I'm sorry, I apologize for
not seeing that.
We'll put that in ordinance form. And Chris, along with your corrections on the travel. All right. Very good. Motion to table this, by the way.
You want to table it or pass it on the first one?
I don't have the ordinance prepared, so I'd be uncomfortable doing that.
All right.
Make motion we table it to March.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Under new business, resolution number 1, 2017, RDC appointments. I'll defer to the clerk to read it into the record.
Resolution number 1, 2017 is a resolution presented by the Common Council to fill the positions on the Redevelopment Commission as required by Indiana state statute. Whereas a Redevelopment Commission has been established by the Common Council of the City of Beech Grove, whereas from time to time commissioners resign their position, and often the time frame between appointments and end of terms cause confusion, and whereas it is recommended that appointments such as these be made on an annual basis to minimize confusion, and whereas the Common Council shall appoint new commissioners and or reaffirm current commission members for a period of 1 year. Therefore, be it ordained that the Common Council desires that the following citizens be appointed to the Redevelopment Commission for a period of 1 year commencing upon approval of this resolution: Donald Webb and Jay Oswald. Therefore, be it ordained that this resolution only applies for the appointments to the Redevelopment Commission and not other commissions or boards. Therefore, be it further ordained that this resolution shall go into effect immediately upon passage by the Common Council, signed by the Council President Pro Tem, attested by the Clerk Treasurer, and signed by the Mayor.
Thank you. Questions or comments?
It's kind of minor, Mayor, but where it says therefore be, it should be resolved, I think, on all.
Where at?
Therefore be it ordained. On one, resolution 1, 2, and 3, it probably just should read resolved. There,
instead of ordained?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's it.
All right. Other than that, motion to approve resolution number 1, 2017.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the same sign. Resolution number 2, 2017 is resolution to fill positions on the Board of Zoning Appeals. I'll defer to the clerk to read it into the record.
Resolution number 2, 2017. Resolution number 2, 2017 is a resolution presented by the Common Council to fill positions on the Board of Zoning Appeals as required by Indiana state statute. Whereas a Board of Zoning Appeals has been established by the Common Council of the City of Beech Grove, whereas from time to time commissioners resign their position, and often the time frame between appointments and end of terms cause confusion, and whereas it is recommended that appointments such as these be made on an annual basis to minimize confusion, and whereas the Common Council shall appoint new Board of Zoning Appeals members and or reaffirm current commission members for a period of 1 year. Therefore, be it further ordained that the Common Council desires that the following citizens be appointed to the Board of Zoning Appeals for a period of 1 year, commencing upon approval of this resolution: Don Whalen, Diana Hendricks, and Julie Weaver. Therefore, be it ordained that this resolution only applies for the appointments to the Board of Zoning Appeals and no other commission or board. Therefore, be it further ordained that this resolution shall go into effect immediately upon passage by the Common Council, signed by the Council President Pro Tem, attested by the Clerk Treasurer, and signed by the Mayor.
Thank you. Floor is open for questions or comments. If not, I'll ask for a motion to approve resolution number 2, 2017 as presented.
I'll make said motion.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye, please.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the same sign. Please register your vote.
Thank you.
All Resolution number 3, 2017 is a resolution that allows the clerk treasurer to proceed with establishing a fund for grant monies received concerning the Arlington and Churchman roundabout. I'll defer to the clerk to read the resolution into the record. Dan?
Resolution number 3, 2017 is a resolution that allows the clerk treasurer to establish a fund for a grant received concerning the Arlington and Churchman roundabout. Whereas the Indianapolis MPO's Regional Freight Committee has recognized that the intersection of Churchman Avenue and Arlington Avenue traffic will be increased by 30% in the next 5 years. And whereas the Indianapolis MPO has awarded the City of Beech Grove approximately $1.6 million for the construction of a roundabout slated for 2019 or 2020, and whereas the Common Council has approved in the 2017 budget funds for engineering services to GAI consultants in the amount of $61,000 for this year alone, whereas GAI consultants each fall until the conclusion of the project will submit to the clerk treasurer the amount of funds needed pursuant to each year's budget to continue the much needed project. Now therefore be it ordained that the Common Council desires that this much needed project proceed and approves the clerk treasurer to proceed with establishing a fund separate from the budget process to manage this grant program. Now therefore be it further ordained that this resolution only applies to the Arlington and Churchman Avenue roundabout construction project and no other budgetary item. Now therefore be it further ordained that this resolution shall go into effect immediately upon passage by the Common Council, signed by the Council President Pro Tem, attested by the Clerk Treasurer, and signed by the Mayor.
Floor is open for any question or comment. Dan, did you want to comment on this one?
Well, what actually happened on this, I've got two bills right now from GAI consultants that I can't pay because I don't have a fund set up for them, and you guys are actually giving me permission to set this fund up and go ahead and place these on the docket for the next meeting. So that's what this is all about.
No questions or comments. I'll ask for a motion to approve resolution number 3, 2017.
I'll make said motion.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed, the same sign. Please register your vote. Yes, Chris.
In anticipation of the next ordinance that we're getting ready to read, I'd like to ask the chief, what's the difference between advanced life support and advanced life support level 2?
It deals with the different levels of care that person's given. If there's the intubation or defibrillation, cardiac is pacing, it's a higher level of response.
Okay. Thank you.
General Ordinance number 1, 2017 is up for approval on first reading this evening. It adjusts ambulance rates for out-of-city responses. This time I will ask the clerk to read the ordinance into the record, please.
General Ordinance number 1, 2017 is an ordinance that amends Chapter 34, Section 34.15B of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Beech Grove, Indiana, pursuant to the ambulance responses outside the corporate city limits of the City of Beech Grove. Whereas Section 34.15B of the Beech Grove Code of Ordinance defines rate fees for emergency ambulance service provided by the City of Beech Grove and its fire department. And whereas more and more our ambulances are being dispatched out of our city to provide basic and advanced life support services, causing a stress on our employees, equipment, and vehicles, and whereas more and more revenues must be generated other than property taxes to help offset the costs associated with provided basic and life-saving services such as ambulance service, and whereas currently provisions call for a difference in fees depending on where the response may be located. Now therefore be it ordained that the Common Council of the City of Beech Grove, Indiana desires to amend Chapter 34, Section 34.15, the Code of Ordinances of the City of Beech Grove, Indiana. Now therefore be it further ordained that the Common Council of the City of Beech Grove amends Chapter 34, Section 34.15B to read as follows. B, the following rate schedule is established for emergency ambulance service provided by the Beech Grove Fire Department for in-city responses. Service, basic life support, rate $700. Advanced life support, rate is $900. Advanced life support, level 2, $1,100. Signature of release, $65. Water rescue, $400. Mileage, $16 per loaded mile. Hazardous material response, $400 for first hour, $25 every 15 minutes after the first hour. Delete out-of-city responses, basic life support, $1,800. Basic life support, non-emergency transport, $1,300. Advanced life support, $2,166. Advanced life support 2, $2,592. ALS non-emergency transport, $1,500. Loaded mileage, $36.61. Add the following. Response outside of the City of Beech Grove corporate limits. Mileage, 39.33 per loaded mile. ALS non-emergency transport, $1,560. ALS level 1 emergency transport, $2,286. ALS level 2 emergency transport, $2,592. BLS non-emergency transport, $1,300. BLS emergency transport, $1,934. Be it further ordained that the Common Council finds it just to amend Chapter 34, Section 34.15B of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Beech Grove, Indiana. Be it further ordained that all ordinances or parts of ordinances in conflict herewith are hereby repealed. Be it further ordained that this ordinance shall go into effect on June 1st, 2017, after passage by the Common Council, signed by the Council President Pro Tem, attested by the Clerk Treasurer, and signed by the Mayor.
Thank you. And I've stapled onto this ordinance what surrounding area ambulance services charge. So we're very consistent. I want to defer real quick to the fire chief for some comments.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. I'll be glad to answer any questions you have on these rate increases. But what I would like to talk to you about is keeping our rates low for the citizens of Beech Grove. I'd like to thank each and every one of you for your support of the fire department and you allowing us to provide the great service that we're able to do. If you look at some of the rate increases, probably the first one you'll notice is the increase in mileage for out-of-city responses. Let me give kudos to Brad over here at the street department. Those guys do one heck of a job keeping our streets clean. They make sure the potholes are patched during the ice and bad weather. Our streets are clear. Kudos to these guys. It saves a lot of wear and tear off of all of our vehicles. And that's something that, you know, we don't look at all the time, but I do have to say thanks. When we go outside the city, it does cause excess wear and tear on our vehicles. We do have to replace tires. We do replace brakes about every 6 months. This week, we're gonna do something new with our ambulances. We're going to cryogenically dip our rotors, and we anticipate our brake jobs to last three times longer. It's a minimal cost, but the outcome and the cascade effects of doing so is gonna be great for our maintenance budget. We do replace tires. When we replace a set of tires on one of the ambulances, it's around $1,500 all the way around. The brakes, when we redo the brakes, again, that's another $1,500. So those small maintenance issues do add up quite quickly. We're running a fleet. We have three ambulances. One is a reserve, but we do have to place it in service, and we have to make sure it's mechanically sound. So that's one of the reasons why those rate increases are there. I do like to thank you for keeping the citizens of Beech Grove safe and keeping the rates lower here in the city. I think we're able to do so because of the amount of our out-of-city responses. And those fees are in line with Indianapolis EMS. So if you have any questions, I would be glad to answer.
This is kind of in the same line as what Chris had was, I imagine most calls are going to be ALS, BLS. What makes it an advanced life support too, just out of curiosity?
When we have to defibrillate, when you use ALS skills, besides just starting an IV, besides just a basic monitoring of the patient, where we're doing defibrillation, where we're doing cardiac pacing, when we're giving certain cardiac drugs.
So every paramedic is capable of the two then?
Yes.
Okay.
Just out of curiosity, if somebody has, if you have a call, so they could go from one level to the other, do those charges accrue then?
No.
So if they start as something, and then they have an event, or they crash, or they get become more problematic?
It's just billed for the service provided.
Okay.
It fits in there.
I'm sure as time progresses, when Dennis first started as a fireman, your guys' run load has increased greatly. You guys are running way more often than you used to. I know now you go outside the city. Have studies been done, Chief? At what point does working 24 hours, and if the men are run, or men and women are running this whole time, when do they start making mistakes? I mean, I know I would if I'm working 24 hours solid, and what's the thought of that?
There's a lot of studies out there now, and they do talk about sleep deprivation, and they talk about the workload.
I know you guys used to get sleep back when maybe you started, Dennis, but I don't know that you do get a lot now.
When I started, they had horses.
It's an ever-changing service, and I believe Councilman Brooks, we talked about this before.
He was in on it, too.
He was part of the...
I was one of the horses.
Horses. And Jim, just to let you know, the month of January of 2017, our ambulance responses, we did 491 ambulance runs for 1 month. And that's close to what was done in a year. So it's...
Yeah. I was so one of the ones responsible for helping get Beech Grove with the first ambulance back in 2002, I think it was. I think one year we had 126 ambulance runs. So the first couple of years we had the ambulance.
In partnership with St. Francis, a lot of our ambulance shifts are 12-hour shifts, so that decreases the chance for those mistakes to be made. It's always good if you have the manpower to rotate your crews 12 hours.
So the paramedics work 12-hour shifts?
The drivers work 12 hours, 12 or 24. And it's studies that you will see in Pittsburgh, out in Las Vegas and Reno, talking to these other fire chiefs. Some would work the 10-hour, 12 schedule. And it was difficult for the adjustment because the number of personnel needed for the shifts. Out west, they try to 48 on, and I think it was 96 off. It was a mess because those guys were sleep deprived. 24 seems to be the optimal number, and we do have some built-in safety factors for overtime. When we have overtime come up at the fire department, we don't allow anyone to work in excess of, 48 hours straight. It's just, we cut that time back. We try to ensure there's a rest period after that 24 hours. And we found out that guys use self-restraint. If there's a shift available, they won't take that next shift that's available that are go home and sleep and sign up for the night shift. So we have some very excellent employees who do use self-restraint and know their own capabilities and how they can perform. So, but it's something we're watching and looking at research on.
And so as run load still continues to increase, what have you guys discussed on that? Have you thought about going to different hourly shifts?
What we would look at doing, Chris, is looking at the medic shifts first and ensuring those are covered by 12-hour shifts. On the fire side, I think it's just a great use of resources to maintain those at 24-hour shifts. But for the ambulances themselves, that would be my first key in to look at.
Just a question out of curiosity as well. So when you use your emergency medicines from your pharmacy, does St. Francis replace those, or do you guys have to cost? Does that come out of your budget?
That comes out of our budget.
I wondered. So all those medications, you have to replace those and make sure check expiration, and so you have to keep close watch.
You get free blankets, can't you?
Oh, we can't get free blankets, but we have to return those.
So I didn't know if so
I need
if
to talk to you later, Chief.
From
what I picked up over there.
Supplied your emergency medication, your.
We work with Indianapolis EMS for our medical supplies and our pharmaceuticals. The only medications we purchase through St. Francis are the Schedule II narcotics.
Okay.
And those are just have a higher chain of custody. So.
Control. Yeah. That's interesting.
Thanks, Chief.
Rob, how comes this is not going into effect till June 1st?
We have to allow us.
Yeah, we have to. It'll be passed in June. You could bump it up, but we did it June 1st last year when you guys approved it. We could bump it up 30 days after you approve it. Doesn't matter.
Okay.
But that just gives it time to notify the billing people.
Transports are by accident, aren't they? I mean, you're going to respond to emergency. You're not going to be, the department doesn't, because I noticed it in here, it's just in here for billing in case it would happen, but it's not a practice.
Correct.
Right.
Any other questions for the chief?
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Thanks.
One other thing, and one thing that has not changed since Councilor Brooks was in on the start, the ambulance service in Beech Grove started in 1973, Project SAVE. And it was never based on your ability to pay. And that it holds true today. Some people cannot pay for service. We billed over $4 million last year. We accept assignment from the government, so we have to take what they give us. So we collected $1.25 million last year, which was really, really good. But just keep that in mind. It's not based on your ability to pay. It's based on your need as a person. So, and that's never changed from day one. So... it's open for any comment. I just think you're being responsible to adjust the rates because this is offsets other dollars. And it's there. So if there's not any questions or comments, I'll ask for a motion to approve General Orders Number 1, 2017 on first reading only.
I'll make a motion to approve on first reading only General Orders Number 1.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed, the same sign. We will hear it on second reading only at the March 6th meeting.
Thank you.
General Ordinance Number 2, 2017 is an ordinance that starts to clean up our code of ordinances with some severely outdated ordinances in the books. You folks did an outstanding job with the personnel manual. So we want to turn our focus to the code of ordinances for this year. So this ordinance is the first of many that will come before you to see if you want to delete outdated ordinances. And I've included the old ordinances with this ordinance for your review. But I'll ask the clerk to read the ordinance into the record, please, on first reading.
Ordinance General ordinance number 2, 2017 is an ordinance that starts the process of updating the code of ordinances for the city of Beech Grove concerning codes that are outdated or no longer apply. Whereas the Beech Grove Public Library recently merged with Marion County Library System, causing our local code to no longer apply, and whereas the Common Council recently passed a new personnel manual causing the posted code of ordinance for employees to no longer apply, and whereas the local code pursuant to fishing in the park is outdated and may not apply anymore, whereas taxi cab licensing is enforced by the city of Annapolis and Marion County was passed here in 1954 without any updates and non-enforcement. Therefore, be it ordained that the Common Council desires to update the code of ordinances for the city of Beech Grove. Therefore, be it further ordained that the Common Council desires the following changes be made to the code of ordinances for the city of Beech Grove. Delete the following without any amendments. Chapter 37, employee policies, delete in its entirety. Chapter 95, fishing at Lake Creek, delete in its entirety. Chapter 97, libraries, delete in its entirety. Chapter 117, taxi cabs, delete in its entirety. Therefore, be it ordained that the Common Council desires the code of ordinances for the city of Beech Grove be updated. Therefore, be it further ordained that this ordinance only applies to the chapters listed above in the code of ordinances. Therefore, be it further ordained that this ordinance shall go into effect 30 days after approved by the Common Council, signed by the Council President Pro Tem, attested by the Clerk Treasurer, and signed by the Mayor.
Thank you. Dan, floor is open for questions or comments.
Well, when this is passed, it means I can fish Lick Creek, huh? Legally.
So will this help? Like, if you're looking for ordinances, this cleanup is going to make it, you know, we've tried to find ordinances and how difficult.
It'll condense our ordinances.
Condense so that, yeah, so things will be more recognizable. So you can recognize them and, yeah.
Mayor, this was kind of brought up by a citizen. Like, this is just one example, but like in our library deletion, elsewhere where we write the makeup of our parks board, it probably needs to be deleted there as well. Just an example of that particular area.
That's a very good point, Counselor. I'd sent the Parks Board and Tom, our Parks Director, a request to update the Code of Ordinances pursuant to Parks and Recreation because, like Buddy said, they're outdated. There are several ordinances. This will be a long process, but I think it will be good. And I think it would be impossible to try to license taxi cabs and with all this Uber and stuff like that. I just think it was, we'd be spinning our wheels.
So you might be surprised what you find when you
look. No. Any other comment or questions?
This was looking good until I pictured the counselor down there fishing and Creek.
With his waders on.
Yeah.
Did the city, do you ever know if the city had a taxi cab station or something like
yes.
that?
Yes. Yeah. Jim Brooks could tell you where it was at.
Man, you're getting hard now, aren't you?
You're not that old. What was it called? Beech Grove Cab Service?
Yes.
Taxi. Was it really? Taxi.
Yeah. Mayor, you've been kind of tough on him tonight. He's wrote your name down here with a funny picture of
it. All right.
Yeah, you're too tough on him.
All right. And if there's no questions or comments, I'll ask for a motion to approve General Orders Number 2, 2017 on first reading only.
I'll make said motion.
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the same sign. We will hear it on second reading at the March 6th meeting. Thank you. One last item of new business, and I'll defer to the clerk. We have one more uniform conflict of interest disclosure statement for Lynn Rackaway. Dan?
Lynn is a Beech Grove firefighter, and he also does our IT work in the city. And So he just wants to make that aware. He's done it every year since I've been here anyway. And so this just standard conflict of interest form.
Questions or comments from council members? If not, I'll ask for a motion to approve the conflict of interest form for Lynn Rackaway.
I'll make the motion to approve.
There's been a motion. Second?
I'll second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the same sign. That concludes new business. I think I'll start tonight with Ed. Ed, we have a special announcement for everyone.
Yes. As of this evening, I'll be stepping down my council seat for District 2. It's been a great privilege and honor to serve on the council for these 9 years I've been on. But there's going to be a new calling for me. I'll be still working more or less in the city. So opportunity has arisen and I had to step down to the council with a conflict of interest. So I want to thank all the citizens of District 2 that have voted for me. And my replacement will be coming from District 2. I have no clue who, but they'll serve out my other 3 years. But thank you, Mayor, for the your leadership, and I wish the council the best as I move on. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
All right. I'll defer to the council pro tem for, do you have any guidance or instruction on how to proceed from there, Bunny?
No. No, well, a little bit. What we're in the process is more of a political thing right now with the fact that the information that Ed has given us, and then I believe there'll be further information given to the county clerk that he is officially going to be resigning. I think that happens tomorrow. But right now, part of it is in the hands, or I should say all of it is in the hands of the Marion County Democratic Party, which is under the chairman of that party. And until we really hear back from them, they'll give us some guidance on exactly what we should do. I don't really want to say anything right now because I could be telling somebody wrong, and I don't want to do that. But Ed's right about one thing. Whoever is going to step in for him will come from District 2, and that's the number one qualification you need. You need to live in that district and certainly be of age. And with those two things, I know for sure. And we'll try to update people as this moves along.
Okay. Chris, we'll start on your end. Comments?
Thank you to everyone for coming. Thank you for the fire department, their new hires. Congratulations to that. It really is about all I have to say.
Liz?
Well, I just want to thank Ed Bell for, he mentored me for the last year. I appreciate his input and his help and assistance. I could always give him a call, and he would always answer my questions, and we had great time conferencing, dialogue, talking about how to be a good council person, so I appreciate his help, and I wish him well.
Thank you.
So. Dave?
Oh, yeah, thank you, everyone, for coming, and I also, too, would like to thank Ed. First 4 years I was on here, Ed was a great help to me. He was a senior councilman, along with Mary, and I appreciate everything you did, Ed. I think you're in your 10th year, and that's saying a lot for the people in your district. They must really like you. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Jim?
Ed, I'd like to thank you for being not only a good counselor, but a good friend. We've came close over the last couple of years, and I appreciate your friendship very much.
Thank you.
Also, this Saturday from 12 to 3, at South Grove Elementary is going to be the Relay for Life chili cook-off. And there's going to be probably 25 different pots of chili there. And it's all free to come down and help yourself and help fight cancer. Thank you.
Buddy?
To Ed, I've known you all my life. You were my sister's wedding. Used to hang around the house. I didn't like you then, and I still. you were just a big. You've been a big part of my life, and sometimes you can forget that as the hustle and bustle of city stuff goes on. But you were part of our family, still part of our family, and I wanted to tell a quick story about we served on the council together under a different mayor a while back, and I was in there trying to do my normal everybody get along routine, and maybe I make it worse sometimes when I do that. But I remember stepping out. I don't know if we can even print this, but I'm going to say it anyway. I remember stepping out of that meeting, and Ed, I go, "How do you think it went?" He said, "Next time I come with you, I'm bringing boots." So I do remember that. And but I know he was Ed when I served with you then, and we haven't had a chance to serve much now. But I know that we agreed a lot. But when we disagreed, that's just what it was. It's what you believed, and you always had a good argument with it. So good luck on your new business with the city. You have a lot of qualifications and inspections and stuff like that. You'll do great. You'll be good for the city. I'd also like to say thanks to the clerk and the mayor on both your reports. You guys included so many things that get forgotten in a year or what's coming up. And Dan putting together the numbers and all the information, the things that your office did, and the mayor complimenting on the things that's happened in the city. You guys did so well your reports tonight that you can actually sleep through this year and just wait on the city and the state address for next year, because you guys did a great job. I do want to thank the new fire personnel for the fire department. They're swearing in tonight. That's the best part of the meeting when you get to watch things like that. It's just they get a new adventure. They get to wear that Beech Grove Fire Department patch. I remember one of our old chiefs, Chief Schwartz, used to say very few people have ever worn these patches, and whether it's police or fire. And so that is a unique thing. So just congratulations to them. And that would be all. Thank you, Mayor.
Ed, any other comments? All right. I want to cut some announcements for the council. February 16th, from 6 to 8 at the Beech Grove R Place, is the second public education on overdose education and reversal training with naloxone. I don't think there's any charge with this. We certainly, if you've never attended a class like that, I would certainly encourage you to attend. This Saturday, February 11th at 10 a.m. in these chambers, the council is going to have a workshop, and it's very important. Hopefully, by that time, Jeff Peters will have a ballpark figure of what we need to do. Plus, we're going to hear some testimony from an attorney who is representing the city of Greenwood and what to expect from citizens. So if you can make it, it would be very important, I think, that you come. The public is invited to attend, but we won't take any testimony from any citizen. This is a workshop, and there will be no decisions made on sewer rates. But I will advise the council that at your next meeting, I'll introduce an ordinance to increase sewer rates on first reading only. And it will be a public hearing. We've done this before. It's not very pleasant, but we have to stay solvent. If the business who treats our wastewater raises their rates, we have no choice but to raise our rates ourselves to remain solvent. So I think this Saturday's meeting will be very, very productive.
When will the citizens energy know what their rates will be? Do you know yet?
The IR, the Indiana Utility Regulatory Commission, I don't know when they're going to make their announcement. They're saying late spring on what they're going to charge to to treat wastewater for the City of Beech Grove, City of Greenwood, City of Lawrence, and the Ben Davis Conservatory District. Those four governmental agencies. And they've already adjusted the rates for their customers. The house that my son lives in, his sewer rate has been adjusted. So we're the last bit of business. So it's not a pleasant topic, but we're going to meet it head on and deal with it. If you're out in the area of Churchman and Arlington, you'll see already some surveying being done. Kinetrix and the company that's buying them out, Parallel 49, and Citizens, they are making a substantial improvement in that intersection to go along with what we're doing. They're moving their big distribution lines out of the way so that this project is very important to them. To get it out of the way, and it's going to cost them hundreds of thousands of dollars to do that because they want to see this project go in. And I'm still working with them on some other funding for us. So that's going on. St. Francis, we met Monday morning, and it was a good meeting, short and sweet, but they're making progress. I meet with Dr. Callahan and Bob Rohde on Wednesday to discuss some things, but it's proceeding very well. There'll be a town hall meeting on March the 14th at Hornet Park at 7 p.m. The public is invited, and the topics of discussion are St. Francis, grant funding, infrastructure, and sewer rates. So that will be March the 14th, 7 p.m. at Hornet Park. And the last thing I wanted to pass on is if you drive out Churchman Avenue, you'll see Miller Pipeline doing some work out in the street, out by the high school. But they're going to be going up and down Churchman all the way to Arlington. They're moving the natural gas lines from the side of the road to under the road to accommodate the sidewalk project that's getting ready to start. And once Citizens Energy is done, then Power and Light will come in and remove all of the street lighting on the south side of the street and install new lighting on the north side. And then once that's done, NDOT should award the bid for the project at March the 1st. And then they suspect within 60 days the project will start. Kudos to the clerk's office for writing a check. The last thing that was done was we had to buy a tiny parcel of land, and that's done. That was done last Friday, Dan?
Last Friday or week?
Friday, I don't remember. But that was the last one, and then they sent us an invoice for 20% of the project, which you folks last year did a resolution to provide money for it, which another good legislation. So then that's it for us, and we're out of the picture. We don't award any bids. Earlier at the Board of Works meeting, they opened bids for the largest paving project since we've been as an administration. This project is big enough that there's going to be paving in all five council districts this year, which is really, really good. So I'll be getting with you about letters to send out to your constituents, letting them know what's going to happen. I'll probably do that 1st of March, as we did in the last year. So that's it. There's nothing much more to report. Ed, my friend, I wish you the best. I think the best compliment that I can give you is that you'll be missed as a council person. So I wish you the best. I know that I will continue to see you in another capacity. So anyway, thank you for your service. I appreciate it very much as mayor and as a citizen. So thank you. Motion to adjourn.
I'm going to say something to you, Mark Rem, our condolences.
Motion to adjourn.
I'll make said motion.
A second.
Meeting is adjourned at 8:35 PM. Thank